Well, this morning, as we start this new year together, please open God's Word to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 17. We are working through, before the Christmas season came, we were working through 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, and we will continue in 2nd Thessalonians next week. But this, well, in 2 weeks when I'll be back, but we will be in a special text this morning in Acts chapter 17 that I believe needs to be all of our New Year's resolutions, at least one, that we make together as a church. We hear this story, and I know you've probably heard it before, about the Bereans. And the Bereans are known for being men and women who studied the Word of God. And I love the description of the Bereans because they are such an excellent example for us. And I pray that First Baptist Pollock would be like First Baptist Berea. We know it was a Baptist church, right? Because all the early churches were Baptist. But anyways, we know that. But anyways, that church in Berea was one which was known for how deeply they studied and maintained and held to the Word of God. And oh, how I want that for First Baptist Pollock. As a pastor, I would say the most painful thing I've ever seen, and I see a lot of painful things. I see families lose loved ones. I see marriages fall apart. I see children estranged from their parents. I see many horrible things, but I think one of the most painful things I've ever seen, to be quite honest, is someone who professed to be a believer go astray into some false teaching. And one of the reasons that's so painful is all those other things I mentioned are temporary problems. One day we will be reunited with our family members. One day that broken marriage will no longer be broken, but everything will be made right. One day that child and their parent will no longer be estranged, but the person who enters eternity without Christ will never be whole again. Never was whole to begin with. And so, when a person wanders away from the faith, especially when they embrace some sort of false teaching, that, more than anything, breaks a pastor's heart. I so hate false teaching. I mean, I hate it. I know what Jesus meant when he said to the Pharisees who were leading people astray from the true gospel, I know what Jesus felt, I think, at least in part. I know what he meant when he said, it would be better for you, false teacher, if you were to have a millstone tied around your neck and to be thrown into the heart of the sea and drowned, rather than for you to lead one of my little children astray. Because what I will do to you in eternal hell will be so much worse than drowning. That's what Jesus said to the false teachers. He asked the Pharisees and the scribes in Matthew 23. He said, you Pharisees, you hypocrites, you brood of vipers, how do you expect to escape the fires of hell? That's how Jesus spoke to those who tried to lead his children astray. And frankly, that's how I as a pastor feel when I hear false teachers trying to lead the children of God astray. I want the people of God to know the Word of God so well that it will be like what Martin Luther said when he was questioned about why he wanted to translate the Bible into German. It had never been done before. And when Martin Luther translated the Bible into German, he said to the cardinal who was questioning him, he said, when I am done, a child who puts his hand to the plow in Germany will know more of the Bible than the Pope in Rome. In other words, my goal is for the people of God, from the children, the lay people, to the oldest. It does not matter. I want them to know the Word of God. And that was the labor of Martin Luther's life and so many other pastors throughout church history. They labored that the people of God would know the Word of God. And you might ask yourself the question, why all this focus on Scripture rather than on Christ? Because it is through Scripture that we know Christ. We don't know Him apart from the Bible. People accuse conservative Christians sometimes of bibliolatry, that we worship the Bible. That is so foolish. Of course we don't bow down to a book. We bow down to the God who wrote the book. And we know it is through the book that He has given us that we know all that we need to know about Him. I mean, it is the one source of revelation that He has given us about Himself. So yes, we rightly focus on this book. And as I deliver this sermon this morning, I am pleading with you. I am pleading with you, church. Everyone here, recommit yourself today to more fervently, more diligently than ever in your life to study the Word of God. I promise it will pay off. Acts chapter 17. We've been looking at the Thessalonians. And I want to begin reading before we get to Berea. I want you to hear what Paul did in Thessalonica, because he does the same thing in Berea. And there is a very different response from Thessalonica than the one he will get in Berea. So Acts chapter 17, verse 1, we read, "Now when they," Paul and those traveling with him, "when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews." The synagogue is the place where the Jews would go and worship every Sabbath, every Saturday. "And Paul went in, as was his custom, and on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the Scriptures." Now, the Scriptures that he would have been reasoning with and preaching from and teaching these Jews from were the 39 books of the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. So he used the Old Testament to teach the Christian gospel. That was really the only Scripture at the time. I mean, maybe a few books of the New Testament had been written, but these Jews, of course, accepted the 39 books of what we call the Old Testament. He reasoned with them from these Scriptures, explaining and proving. Now, the only way you can do that is by going into the text and say, "You see what Isaiah said? You see what Micah said? You see what Moses said?" Yeah, that was about Jesus. Explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and rise from the dead, saying, "This Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Christ." That is, He is the Messiah. The Greek word Christ is the equivalent of the Hebrew Messiah. You remember last Sunday when I showed you the messianic prophecies that Jesus fulfilled, and I only showed you a small portion of the many hundreds of them? That's what Paul did. He went in and said, "You see this prophecy? Jesus fulfilled it, and only He fulfilled it. You see this one? Jesus fulfilled it, and only He fulfilled it." And he began to show them that, listen, Jesus is the only one who could possibly be the Messiah. And so what happens is, verse 4, "Some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas." There were people who were converted, as did a great many of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. "But the Jews were jealous, and taking some of the wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, and they set the city in an uproar, and they attacked the house of Jason." Jason was one of the believers, one of the Christians, "seeking to bring them out of the crowd. And when they could not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities, shouting, 'These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also, and Jason has received them. And they are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus.'" Yeah, you're right, there's another king. He's the King of all kings. Verse 8, "And the people and the city authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go." So Paul gets kicked out of Thessalonica for preaching the gospel. Not a bad way to go out, right? Proclaim the truth, and if it gets you imprisoned and then you have to leave, so be it. So Paul goes to the next town as he's traveling down the peninsula there that is modern-day Greece, and he goes down to Berea. And in verse 10, there is a different reception in Berea. The brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went into the Jewish synagogue. Same thing. They go in on the Sabbath and they preach from the Old Testament that Jesus is the Christ. Same message. New town. Verse 11. Now these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness. Let me just translate that for you. They didn't fall asleep during the sermon. They received the word with all eagerness. They wanted to hear the word of God. They were hungry. I mean, they were feasting on the truth of Scripture as Paul was preaching it to them, and they loved it. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the Scriptures daily. What does that mean? Every day. After they heard Paul preach, they studied the Word of God. They didn't just hear it on Sunday or Saturday, as was the Jewish custom. And then when they became Christians, they worshiped on the Lord's Day on Sunday. They didn't just receive it once a week. No. Every day, in their own time, outside of the public worship service, they each, in that church, individually were examining the Scriptures daily to see if these things were so. They didn't just accept what Paul said as true. They didn't just believe it because the preacher said so. They examined, they studied, they looked deeply into the Word of God themselves to see if what they were hearing preached was actually the truth. Verse 12, many of them therefore believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing, as well as men. There were poor and rich and everyone in between who made up that church. Verse 13, and when the Jews from Thessalonica learned that the word of God was proclaimed by Paul at Berea also, they came thereto agitating and stirring up the crowds. So the ones who threw him out of Thessalonica come down to Berea to kick him out of there. Verse 14, then the brothers immediately sent Paul off on his way to the sea, but Silas and Timothy remained there. Those who conducted Paul brought him as far as Athens after receiving a command for Silas. Timothy came to him as soon as possible, and they departed. So Paul had to leave, but he left behind Timothy and Silas, who were able preachers of the Word of God and who labored faithfully and would have taught the very same truths Paul taught. It didn't have to be Paul preaching and teaching there. But this morning, what I want to do is I want to focus on what it was that was so special about the Berean people and how they handled the Word of God. Imagine this. You're a Jewish believer. You've been told your whole life to be looking for a Messiah who will come and rescue the nation of Israel from the Roman hands. And this man who used to be a Pharisee and is now a Christian named Paul shows up, and he is preaching to you in the Jewish synagogue that Jesus is the Messiah. And the Messiah is far different than what you've expected your whole life. You were looking for a human king. He is a heavenly king. You were looking for one who would overthrow Rome. This Jesus had no interest in challenging Rome. You were looking for one who would be a conqueror, who would kill all his enemies. Jesus was killed by his enemies as a suffering servant. I mean, he's just the opposite of what they expected. And you can't be surprised that the Jews in Thessalonica said, hey, look, that's not who the Messiah is supposed to be. But here's the thing. The Jews in Berea said, well, I'm not sure about who the Messiah is supposed to be and whether or not Jesus is him. But there is one thing I am absolutely certain about. This is God's word. this Bible, it is from God. God has spoken in these scriptures. And so if what Paul is telling me is the truth, it's going to be here in the Bible. And so they said, one thing I know for sure is scripture is true. So I'm going to take what this man is teaching and preaching to me, and I am going to analyze it according to what scripture says. And I'm going to hear him out. And if what he says does not agree with scripture, I'm not going to listen to him. But if what he says is in fact what the Word of God says, and if he's not preaching his own message but God's message, then I have to obey and I have to follow Jesus if he is the Messiah that the Old Testament told us would come. And guess what? They studied daily. They wanted to know. This was important to them. They could wait. They had other activities that they put off and delayed, and they committed themselves to the study of God's word. And these are lay people in the church, just like all of us. They were just regular people who wanted to know the truth about Jesus. They had to know. They couldn't be satisfied with letting the preacher study it and tell them. No, they had to know for themselves. They had to know the chapter and verse. They had to understand these things for themselves. And the more they studied, the more they realized that Jesus is King, he is God, he is Savior, and he was worthy of their worship. And many of them began to believe as they continued to examine the scriptures every day and hear the Word of God preached by faithful pastors. That's what I want our church to look like. You might ask the question, well, Pastor, is that what's most important, that we study the Bible? Well, ultimately what's most important is that God receive all glory. That's the very purpose for which we were created, was to glorify God. However, how does God receive glory? I mean, which God are we going to worship? How do we know who the true God is and how he wants to be worshiped? How can we know how we are made right with him? Through his word. That's how we know those things. We don't just figure it out on our own. We have to go to the Word and learn who he is and what he requires of us and what he wants of us and how he has provided provision of salvation. And we must study these things daily, because if we do not, we will not be able to know the truth and the lie. We will not be able to discern. We will not be able to take what this world says and filter it and figure out what is of God and what is not. One of the most painful things that ever happened, there was a young man, I won't name him, I don't think any of you know him, but there was a young man that I grew up with in my home church. He was in the youth group with me, just a few years older than me. He came from a very devout Christian family, and church every time the doors were open, just like me, and so we grew up in the same church together. And he came back to preach for homecoming one Sunday, and he was preaching that salvation is not all of grace, but it's also partly of works. And that God does part and we have to do the rest. And I immediately was like, whoa, that's not what the Bible says. And I was concerned. And our pastor was too. And we were really worried about what is he saying exactly. And he was kind of convoluted in the sermon that he was preaching. And we never invited him back to preach. I was associate pastor and our pastor. We were both very concerned, and I was really worried, and I talked to him afterward, and he said, oh, I don't think you guys were understanding me, this and that. And I said, well, you said salvation is not all of God's grace. It's also partly what we do. The Bible says it is by grace you are saved through faith. This is not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, so that no one may boast. Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. So that doesn't compute. And what shocked me was, number one, that someone who had been raised in that church had turned away to such false teaching, because it in time became clear that he in fact did believe that salvation was not all of grace, but that it was partly man's work, that it was partly up to us to earn our way to heaven. And then number two, what concerned me even more was that many in our church didn't see the problem with his sermon. That many just said, hey, he's one of us. He was real passionate, sounded good. And I said, yeah, he was a good communicator. He spoke well, but what he spoke wasn't what the Bible says. That's a problem. And he went on, this young man, to embracing what is commonly called now the Hebrew Roots Movement. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but they're basically a group of people. They often call themselves Messianic Jews, and they're not even Jewish by birth, but they essentially keep the law of Moses. They call themselves Torah observant. So they keep the dietary restrictions, all the parts of the law that Hebrews 8 says are obsolete, the ceremonial laws, they keep all those. And so they observe all of the distinctly Jewish laws that were fulfilled at the cross, and we no longer are held to. And they say that you can't be saved unless you do all these things. They are very similar to the Judaizers that Paul condemns in the book of Galatians. And I thought to myself, as I began to see him become a part of this cultic movement, I thought to myself, I mean, does he not read the Bible and know that that's not right? And I thought back, and I looked back on the pastors that we grew up under, and thought to myself, you know, there was a lot of preaching and teaching about come to Jesus and give your heart to him, but there was not much preaching and teaching about the content of Scripture and what it is to be saved and how we know the truth. And I don't remember the pastors I grew up under ever preaching through a book of the Bible. It was always the pastor just came on Sunday and preached whatever the Lord laid on his heart, and what ended up with is you only heard what the pastor was his favorite topic or passage of Scripture. And what I realized was, is growing up, it's not that our pastors taught us bad things, it's just they didn't teach us enough. They didn't teach us deep enough, and we had such a shallow faith and a superficial understanding of the Bible that we were vulnerable to false teaching. And it was only by the grace of God that I went on to have better teachers when I went to Louisiana College, who taught me to love the Word of the Lord and study it deeply. And I got a pastor later that he didn't sit under who preached expositional sermons. What do I mean by expositional sermons? It's essentially where the point of the sermon is the point of the passage of Scripture. You don't preach your thoughts. You preach what God said in His Word. So you go to Acts 17 and say, okay, what's the point? The point is the Bereans took seriously the Word of God. Therefore, the sermon is we need to do what they did. It's not where you have something you want to say and you quote the Bible to illustrate what you have to say. No, it's the Bible says this, now let me help you understand better what God has spoken in His Word. And the first time I ever heard that kind of preaching, I was, I believe, 16 years old. And so for the first part of my life, I love those pastors, and I'm not saying they weren't faithful men, but I didn't get the richness of the depths of God's Word that I needed. And I realized that all of these truths that I had begun to embrace, this young man never heard when we were growing up. And so he was susceptible to heresy and has gone fully into that and embraced it. And to this day, it breaks my heart, and I pray for him that he would come to know the truth and salvation by grace through faith alone in Christ alone. I say that to tell you that as a pastor, I want to make sure that you know the Word of God, and that if you do not know Christ, it's not my fault for not faithfully teaching. Paul said to the Ephesian elders in Acts 20, he said, My hands are innocent of the blood of all of you because I have not neglected to proclaim to you the whole counsel of God. In other words, if you go to hell, it won't be my fault because I preach to you all of Scripture. And as a pastor, I know when I stand before Jesus, I will give an account. Did I faithfully preach and teach the Word of God to this church? And if I did not, Jesus said, it'd be better for you to be thrown into the ocean with a millstone tied around your neck than to face me on that day. So I take it seriously. I preach expository sermons not because I like to preach a long time or because I want you to think that I'm smart or anything like that. I preach the way I do because I'm absolutely certain that this book is the Word of God, and if we faithfully read it and study it, we will, as individuals and as a church, grow. And that God will bless this church through the faithful study and proclamation of His Word. That the Word of God does not return void. That it never fails to accomplish that for which God has purposed it. I want to show you some passages in Scripture now as we think about the Bereans and their commitment to the Bible. You know, we're not told here that they were an exceptionally holy people or that they ministered to the poor or did all those things, but I'm confident that they probably did those things. Why? Because if they studied the Bible, then all those things come with it. Let's look at Psalm chapter 19. One of my favorite psalms. I love Psalm chapter 19 and what it says about the Word of God. Now this psalm begins with talking about what we call general revelation, how God has revealed Himself in nature. And it says, you know, the heavens declare the glory of the God, and the skies above proclaim His handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. And what he says is that you can know a lot about God by looking at His creation. I mean, a lot is revealed about God and His greatness and His glory and His grandeur when you look at what He has created. But then in Psalm 19, verse 7, he turns from general revelation, how God has revealed Himself through His creation, and he talks about special revelation. The law of the Lord, which is Bible speak for Scripture, the Bible. And so in speaking about the Scriptures, Psalm 19, verse 7, we read, the law of the Lord is perfect. The first thing you need to know about your Bible is perfect. This word perfect doesn't only mean that it's all true. It means that, and your Bible is all true. It also means it's complete. It's not lacking anything. God hasn't given you 95% of the truth. He's given you 100% right here in a book in your hands that you can read anytime you want. The law of the Lord is perfect. It's all true, and it's all you need. Reviving the soul. In other words, you study the Bible, you will have a revival in your soul. And if a church studies the Bible together, we will have a revival in this church. We don't have to bring in a big name flashy preacher. We just have to commit ourselves to the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit will bring a revival if we will study His Word. The testimony of the Lord is sure. If it's in the Bible, you can be certain of it. I love that. So often people say things like, well, I don't know a lot about theology, and I'm not so sure, and, you know, I don't know, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. Especially when we're talking about very important doctrines, it concerns me when Christians say, well, yeah, I don't know about whether or not salvation is all of grace and not any works, you know. Protestants believe this, Catholics believe that, Mormons believe this, and I'm just not sure. And I was raised to believe this, but if I was raised that way, I'd probably believe that. That's true. You tend to stay in the faith that you were raised in. You tend to do a lot of things that you were raised to do throughout the rest of your life. But I'm a Christian not because I was raised to be a Christian. I'm a Christian because God's Word is true. And Christianity is simply the Bible embraced and lived out in the life of an individual. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. What that means is even the person who doesn't have some great education can be wise and know much if he or she will simply study the Word of God. You don't have to have a seminary degree to know the Bible very well. And if you know the Bible very well, let me tell you something. All those unbelieving so-called Bible scholars on the Discovery Channel and the History Channel telling us Jesus didn't really rise from the grave and all that kind of stuff, they are idiots compared to any church member in this church. I'm serious. Because wisdom comes from the Word of God, not from degrees. I'm not diminishing education. I think it's important. But real spiritual insight and wisdom comes from the study of Scripture. And the Bible says it makes wise the simple. That is, even the person who's just the common man or woman who will commit themselves to the study of God's Word can know much about theology and can have much to say. But your knowledge of heavenly things will only be as deep as your study of the Bible. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. Do you love God's Word? I enjoy reading and studying God's Word. It truly delights my heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. I mean, everything in this world is tainted by someone who wants to get something out of us. It seems like everyone's got a sales pitch at the end of the day, but the Bible is just this beautiful, wonderful book where God just wants to reveal himself to us so that we can be more like his Son. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. I mean, this is stuff that never grows old. The Bible doesn't have an expiration date. One of my favorite pastors, Steve Lawson, says, the Bible is more relevant than tomorrow's newspaper. Amen? I mean, this book does not go out of date. It's not like that milk in your refrigerator that you smell and go, I don't know if I want to drink this. This book is eternal. These truths never wear out. I mean, you study science and theory changes throughout time and history, and the things we once believed we now know are not right, and things we believe today in 20 years we'll probably find out we were wrong about. But the Bible, no, it stays the same always, and you can trust it. There's a little old phrase that I like to use: if it's new, it's not true. I mean, it's been in the Bible for 2,000 years, and if someone comes along with some new doctrine, it's not true. How do I know it's not true? Because the Bible hadn't changed, therefore the truth hasn't changed. It's that simple. And it's wonderful to have that sort of confidence that I know the truth, not because I'm so smart, but because God has told me what the truth is. And I have full confidence in what God has said. I can read it. I can know it. I am able to know the words of God because he's given them to me. The rules of the Lord are true, and they are righteous altogether. Verse 10, more to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. If you could have a fortune, just billions of dollars, just truckloads of gold, or if you took that fortune, you could never read a Bible again, what would you take? The psalmist David says, I'd take the Word of God. Because that gold is not near as valuable as the Word of Almighty God. Sweeter also than honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. If you would just read God's Word, if you would just study God's Word, if you would apply yourself to this book, it will pay off. So what do we need to do? In whatever way you want to, you need to commit starting today. It is the first day of the new year, after all, to studying God's Word more diligently. Maybe you need a Bible reading plan where you're going to read through the Bible in a year. If you've done that before, I would encourage you to pick a book of the Bible. Maybe get a good commentary on a book of the Bible. If you want to know some good ones, just come and talk to me. You know, I could throw out a few names that you pretty much always can get a good commentary if you get them from a certain author. But on certain books of the Bible, there's one commentary that'd be really great, and so it would take a while to go through that. But if you want some help, come and talk to me or Dalton, and we can help you. But you need to commit yourself to studying God's Word diligently and faithfully. there is a tendency in churches, and by the grace of God, I see our church doing less and less of this, but there's a tendency in many churches where the people just trust the pastor to figure it all out, right? I don't know, ask the pastor. Well, I don't know about that. We'll see what the pastor says. Well, the pastor is there to lead the church and guide the church, but listen, the people ought to know these things too. I mean, this isn't some special knowledge for a couple guys in suits or in robes. I mean, this is the word of God for the people of God. And like Martin Luther, I want a child to know more than the Pope in Rome. I mean, I want the people of our church to be Bible scholars. You say, well, I'm not going to have a degree. That's okay. You can know the Bible well if you will take the time to study it, and it will pay dividends. I mean, how much time do we waste watching television or waste on some activity, sports, hunting, whatever? When I go hunting, I read the Bible a lot, but anyways, you know, I love to study God's word, and one of the reasons is because I know it's going to pay off. I never spend time reading the Bible and go, boy, that was a waste. But how many football games have you watched and at the end of it go, man, I wish I could have those 4 hours of my life back? You know what I'm saying? I mean, you'll never spend time in this divine book, unlike any other book or source of knowledge in the whole universe, and come away regretting it. When young men come to me who feel a call to the ministry, and they ask me, what do I do to prepare for ministry, and what do I need to do, and what's a good seminary, and things like that, I'll often tell them, seminary's good. It's a good idea to go. I don't think you have to, but it certainly would be good. Do it if you can. But what I often tell them is a lot of times they're looking for some secret inside knowledge of how to be a good pastor or how to prepare to be a good pastor. And I will just tell them, study the Bible a lot. And a lot of times what I'll do is I'll question young men who want to go into ministry, and I'm going to say, okay, you've just gone to a family's house. Their two-year-old child died during the night, just suddenly, unexpectedly, didn't wake up the next morning. What verse of scripture are you going to share with them? They ask you, is my child in heaven? And they might say, oh, well, you know, I believe that when children die, they go to heaven. Well, no offense, but they don't care what you believe. They want to know what God has said. Can you show them in the Bible what God has said about that? Because if you can't show them in the Bible, you're not going to help them very much. They don't want your opinion. They want God's word. A man and his wife come to you and say that they're thinking about getting a divorce because they just can't get along anymore. What do you tell them? What passage of scripture do you take them to? And you see, if a man cannot answer those questions quickly and know where to go, he's not ready to be a pastor. He's not. But more than that, our regular church members should be familiar with these things. And you see, we expect so little, I believe, of our church members in churches today. We just want them to come and give and attend and let the preachers and the hired professionals do all the work. But in Ephesians chapter 4 says, God has called pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. The work of the ministry is ours as a church. It's not the pastors or the missionaries. The whole church is to do the work of the ministry. If you attended, and I know they don't mind me saying this, so I'm going to. If you attended the angel of the wedding of Ben and Angel just here a few months ago, you saw an amazing thing. And I know Ben doesn't mind me sharing his story. He came to this church on a Sunday night. We were worshiping in the fellowship hall. Some of you may remember because the AC was going out over here. And he came, and I was teaching on Baptist history. And he had grown up in church and hadn't gone for the rest of his life. And he said at this point, you know, he was an agnostic. He didn't know if God existed, but he was pretty sure God didn't exist. And Angel dragged him to church. And she was a new Christian. I had just baptized her, led her to the Lord and baptized her. And Angel drug him to church. And he came and listened, and he heard me talk about Baptist history and how liberals got away from the Bible. And when they got away from the Bible, they no longer had an authority, a foundation, and so anything went. And I said, but we have a word of God that is sure, that is certain. I remember he came up to me afterward, and he said, I grew up in liberal Baptist churches. The very things you're talking about, I grew up in New York State, where he grew up. And he told me, he said, I've never heard someone explain it like that. And he said, it makes sense that you would believe these things if you're convinced God actually said that they're true. That it's not one person having their own beliefs and sets of opinions over another person's, but God's actually said this is the way things are and we can know it. And he told me he found that intriguing, but he wasn't even sure if God existed and all this. And so I said, hey, look, brother, I shared the gospel with him. I said, just keep coming. Just keep coming. And we prayed for him, and we shared the gospel with him, and he just kept coming to church. And before you know it, he said, Brian, I've given my life to the Lord. I want to follow him. And then before you know it, men and angel, and their relationship grows, and they get married, and I baptize him, and I marry them, and dedicate their children. They're going to be moving soon. Ben is in the Army, and they're going to be going to Georgia soon. And we're going to miss them. But what happened when they got married, if you weren't here, you need to see this. Recorded their wedding. You can go to the church's YouTube page and watch it. When Ben first gave me, I said, y'all write your wedding vows and let me see them, you know, and I'll review them. Ben gave me 11 pages single-spaced of wedding vows. I said, Ben, go home and read that and time yourself. Tell me how long it takes. He said, it took me, I think it was 18 minutes. I said, Ben, wedding vows are supposed to be short. I said, now, they're really good. I read them. They're really good. But can you whittle that down a little bit? And so he went back, and I think he got it down to 7 or 8 minutes. And I said, all right, that'll do. And so we come for the wedding, and I knew what he was going to say. I'd read it. And he got up. She gave her wedding vows, which were really good too. But when he gave his wedding vows, one of the things he did, he started with a Trinitarian prayer to the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. And he thanked the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, each for their role in saving he and Angel from their sins. And how he was a new Christian, and he was blind, and didn't even believe God existed. And now he's a believer, and God has given him this amazing wife who he just recently saved her. And just a few years ago, both of them didn't know the Lord, and now they were in a church and had a church family, and God had been changing their lives, and God had brought them together. And he talked about how Christ loves his bride, the church, and died for her, and how he was going to do the same thing for his bride. And he just laid his heart out there, and he committed before God and the church that he was going to do all these things. And man, I saw the people's faces, and I talked to many of you after the wedding. And you were just like, that was amazing. How did he know all? Did you? I had people say, did you write those vows for him? No, I did not. I just asked him to condense them a little bit. And y'all thought that was funny for me to tell someone to not speak so long. But anyways, the point is, a man who didn't even believe God existed 2 years ago stood up in a wedding in this church and showed that he had better theology than many of the preachers in our nation. It's true. How did that happen? I can tell you how. I know how, because I've been discipling Ben over the last 2 years. He reads the Bible a lot. He studies God's word. And he would come to me, and he would have questions, and he was just growing in his faith. And because he spent time, and Ben, he's the kind of guy, man, he just goes after it. Sometimes hours a day reading the Word of God. He grew so quickly in his faith. And he's just a regular guy. And I see God working in Angel's life, in her heart, the same way. Are they perfect people? No. But man, God changed them a lot really fast. And how did he do it? Through his Word. And so I would ask you, Christian church member, you've been in this church for many years, how much have you been growing in your faith lately? If the answer is not very much, I bet you haven't been reading the Bible very much either, have you? Just be honest with yourself. Your growth in your relationship with the Lord will be directly proportional to your study of His Word. You can go no higher than how deep you have gone into the Word of God. You simply cannot worship God more and serve Him more if you do not know Him better through the Scriptures. So whatever you need to do, a daily Bible reading plan, read through the Bible in a year, study a book of the Bible, you want to come to me for ideas and help, every one of us, and this will be myself included, need to study the Bible in 2017 a whole lot more than we did in 2016, and watch what God does in this church if we do that. I promise you there will be a revival if we will seek God in His Word and pray that He will help us to understand and that He will work in this church. I promise you there will be a revival if we do that. I know it because Scripture promises us that revival will happen if we do these things, because God works through His Word and His people when we study His Word. And so let's do that this year together. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank You for Your Word and for each one here. And Lord, I just ask that You would just help us to love Scripture more and read it and study it faithfully, and not only just know it, but live it. Oh, how we pray that Your Holy Spirit would just change our hearts as we read our Bible every day. Help us to know the truth, love the truth, live the truth, proclaim the truth until Jesus comes again. And God, we know You will do great and powerful things through this little church in Pollock, Louisiana, because You are a great and awesome God. Jesus has promised the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. And so, Lord, I am praying that You would send these people and this church out into the harvest field of Grant Parish and the surrounding area to do the work of the ministry. And we know that You will provide the fruit. Help us to be faithful. We know You will be faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.